بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد today inshallah ta'ala as we have announced we're going to do the fiqh of Umrah and also talk about some of the blessings of Umrah and some practical advice for performing the Umrah. And inshallah, I hope to leave an adequate time for question and answer. And of course, this is relevant especially to those of us who are going on this trip in around a week and a half, inshallah. And even a week, yes. It is a week, isn't it?
Next Wednesday.
Less than a week. This week, exactly. Yes, sorry, exactly. I said a week and a half. A week. And for those of us who are, inshallah, going in the future, it is going to be of benefit to all concerned. The word Umrah comes from i'tamara, and it means to intend and to visit. Al-qasd wa-ziyara, to intend and to visit. And of course, when we use it in the Islamic sense, we mean we intend to visit the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is the intention to visit the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Umrah is an act of worship that, according to some madhahib, is in fact fard. And this is a surprise to many of you, I know, because the predominant position is that Umrah is sunnah. But in fact, there are a number of positions of the classical scholars who said that Umrah is in fact a fard. And we're going to come to this in a while. Now, how many Umrahs did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do? The scholars of Sirah tell us our Prophet performed 4 Umrahs in his life. That we consider that the Prophet performed 4 Umrahs, even though one of them he didn't actually perform, but he will get the reward of. So we say that our Prophet performed 4 Umrahs in his life. The first of these Umrahs is the Umrah that is called the Umrah of Hudaybiyah. The Umrah of Hudaybiyah. And this is the Umrah that in the 6th year of the Hijrah, the Prophet ﷺ was prevented from entering Mecca. And so he camped outside of Mecca, and therefore there was a negotiation between the Quraysh and the Prophet ﷺ, and eventually he was asked to go back and return the next year. So Allah gave him the reward of Umrah without him actually performing Umrah. Now, this instance is actually very useful for us to discuss a tangent of fiqh before we go on to the other three, and that is, what happens when you're prevented from doing Umrah? And there is a term in Arabic that is used in the Quran and in the Sunnah, and it is ihsar. فَإِنْ أُحْصِرْتُمْ فَمَسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. Ihsar. And ihsar means to be prevented from going and performing the Umrah. And the position of the Maliki and the Shafi'i school of law is that ihsar occurs only when an enemy prevents you from going to do Umrah. Whereas the Hanafis and one of the riwayats of the Hanbali says that ihsar can also be your own problem. You fell sick. According to the Malikis and Shafi'is, if you fell sick, this is not ihsar. Tough luck, you're going to have to do something. But according to the other two madhab, and inshallah this is the strongest position, if there's a legitimate excuse, and who defines legitimate? Common sense. Common sense. As a person has suffered a stroke, person has fallen severely ill, something has happened. If there's a legitimate excuse and the Umrah has to be broken, the same applies for Hajj, then فَإِنْ أُحْصِرْتُ فَمَسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. This is according to the Quran. That if you are prevented from doing the Umrah or the Hajj, then you must give some type of sacrifice and you are allowed to basically exit your ihram right then and there and shave your hair, and then you perform, you make it up whenever you're able to make it up. And this is for those who have a legitimate excuse. And legitimate excuse, as we said, is a dire need, not something trivial, obviously, or else this is a major sin. And in fact, according to one interpretation, you would not even get out of ihram if it was not a serious issue. Also, in order to get out of the problem of ihsar, scholars say that we can follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he advised one of the sahaba who was worried about completing the umrah, the hajj, he said, why don't you put a condition in your niyyah when you make the niyyah, and you say, oh Allah, if any cause prevents me from doing the hajj, then I will become halal, meaning I will remove my ihram wherever that cause affects me. فَإِنْ حَبِسَنِي حَابِسْ فَمَحَلِّ حَيْثُ حَبَسْتَنِي. If a habis, if a cause prevents me, then I become free of my ihram wherever that cause happened. If you make this clause, According to the majority opinion, if there's a need and you make this clause, you don't even have to give an animal. But that's only if there's a legitimate excuse and you put that clause in the beginning of your niyyah. So this is the first umrah of the process, and I went into a bit of a fiqh tangent for this need. Inshallah, I pray that that happens to none of us, that we're able to complete the umrah, so we don't have to worry about what is called ihsar. The second umrah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did is called the umratul qada. And it's called the umratul qada because he made up. What did he make up? Hudaybiyah. Right, and it took place in the next year after Hudaybiyah, and this is seventh year of the Hijrah, and it took place in the month of Dhul-Qa'dah. And by the way, all of the Umrahs of the Prophet ﷺ took place in the month of Dhul-Qa'dah, or at least they were started in the months of Dhul-Qa'dah, just by a coincidence that all of the Umrahs, they were started, and all of them finished except for one in the month of Dhul-Qa'dah. The third Umrah of the Prophet ﷺ was the Umrah that he did after the conquest of Mecca, when he returned to Mecca after conquering Mecca. In other words, he conquered Mecca, and this was in Ramadan of the eighth year of the Hijrah, right? We're going to talk about this inshallah in the Sirah classes. He conquered Mecca, then he went on to attack which city? Who can remind me? Who can tell me? After Mecca, Ta'if and Hunayn. Both of them are together, Hunayn and Ta'if, one after the other, right? Ta'if and Hunayn. Then on the way back, he went back to Mecca, and he did Umrah. Then he returned to Medina. Right? And this is called Umratul Ji'irrana. Umratul Ji'irrana. Ji'irrana is the station, the land outside of Mecca that the Prophet ﷺ changed his ihram into, so that it was called the Umratul Ji'irrana. Right? So this is the third Umrah that he did, and this was in the eighth year of the Hijrah, and it also began in the month of Dhul-Qa'dah, and it actually finished the month of Dhul-Qa'dah, so also in the eighth year, he did it in the month of Dhul-Qa'dah. And then the final Umrah that he did is the Umrah of Hajjatul Wada', the Umrah of Hajj, right? And what type of Hajj did our Prophet do? We went over this in the Fiqh of Hajj. What type of Hajj? Hajj Qiran. He did Hajj Qiran. And Hajj Qiran means you do an Umrah and you do a Hajj with the same Ihram. So our Prophet ﷺ did an Umrah and he did a Hajj in the same Ihram. Tamattu' means you do Umrah, you get out, and then you return to Umrah. You do Umrah, you get out of Ihram, then you return to Umrah. This is Tamattu', right? And Ifrad means you just do the Hajj, you don't do any Umrah. And our Prophet ﷺ did Hajj Qiran, which means he did a full Umrah. And this is the fourth and final Umrah that he did. And he began it in Dhul-Qa'dah, but he finished it in Dhul-Hijjah. He began, meaning he walked. He was walking in Ihram in Dhul-Qa'dah, but he actually performed the Umrah in the first days of Dhul-Hijjah. These are the four Umrahs that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. And the blessings of Umrah are numerous. The blessings of Umrah are many. Of the most authentic ahadith about the blessings of Umrah, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Al-umratu ila al-umrati kaffaratun lima baynahuma." From one Umrah to the next Umrah, it will be a forgiveness for all of the sins done in between the two of them. Al-umratu ila al-umrati kaffaratun lima baynahuma. Right? And in one version, the Prophet ﷺ made a longer hadith, and he said from one Jumu'ah to the next Jumu'ah, and one from Umrah to the next Umrah, and from Ramadan to the next Ramadan, كَفَارَةٌ لِمَا بَيْنَهُمَا إِذَا اجْتُنِبَتِ الْكَبَائِرِ. If the major sins are avoided. So he made a condition, he made a clause, that Umrah, it forgives what we call the minor sins, and it does not forgive the major sins. Right? The major sins, you need to repent, and you need to ask Allah for forgiveness, but the minor sins, they are forgiven through the Umrah. And so from one Umrah to the next Umrah, it is a kafara. It is a expiation of the sins that have been committed in between the two Umrahs. And Ibn Qayyim and others, they mention that it is incorrect to use this hadith to commit sins. Which is the many ignorant people that say, okay, I'm going to do Umrah this year, inshallah next year also do Umrah, I have a green light to commit sins. He said this attitude is not what the Sharia intends. Rather, it is an encouragement that if for you to do another Umrah, that inshallah ta'ala, it will be an encouragement for you that the sins that you have done from the previous Umrah, you will repent from those sins and turn over a new leaf. Not that you have a green light to do all sins until you do the next Umrah. And also, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Umrah increases one's wealth. Umrah makes you rich, basically, right? There are certain things that the Prophet ﷺ said, if you do it, you will get more wealth, you will get more money. And of them is Umrah. Also of them, by the way, is to be good to one's relatives. to be good to one's relatives also helps in this regard. Our Prophet ﷺ said, تابعوا بين الحج والعمرة فإنهما ينفيان الفقر والذنوب كما ينفي الكير خبث الحديد والذهب والفضة. رواه الترمذي. That frequent between Hajj and Umrah, frequent, always follow one up with another. تابعوا, once you finished one, be eager to do another. Don't just say, okay, khalas, which is the attitude of most Muslims, by the way, is that one Hajj they want to do and khalas, that's it. One Umrah and that's it. Our Prophet said, tabi'u, follow up. Taba'a means to come after another. Tabi'u bayn al-Hajj wal-Umrah, that frequent between Hajj and Umrah, because the two of them, Hajj and Umrah, they cleanse a person from faqr, poverty, and from sins, dhunub. Like a furnace purifies iron and gold and silver. So you have raw gold, you take it out of the ground. In those days, how would they purify it? They would put it into the furnace, and then they would chip away the raw material, and then the pure gold would come out, right? Or any other raw material, when you put it in the furnace, it will come out pure, and the impurities would fall out. Our Prophet ﷺ said, Umrah and Hajj, it basically causes your faqr to fall away, your poverty to fall away, and your dhunub to fall away. So doing Hajj and Umrah brings wealth in your life. And doing Hajj and Umrah forgives your sins. Also, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described Umrah as being a type of jihad. And he said that Hajj and Umrah is the jihad of weak people who cannot do other types of jihad. Right? If for some reason we cannot do other types of jihad, the jihad that we're able to do is the jihad of Hajj and Umrah. And Aisha came to the Prophet ﷺ and asked, Ya Rasulullah, هَلْ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ مِنْ جِهَادٍ. Is jihad obligatory upon women? Do we have to go and do jihad? And our Prophet ﷺ said, عَلَيْهِنَّ جِهَادٌ لَا قِتَالَ فِيهِ الْحَجُّ وَالْعُمْرَةِ. رواه الترمذي. It is obligatory on them to do a jihad in which there's no fighting. Hajj and Umrah. So he called it the jihad. And it is a type of jihad that you will get reward for the sufferings and the pains that you do. And in another hadith in Tirmidhi, our Prophet ﷺ said, Jihadul Kabiri wal-da'ifi wal-mar'ati al-hajj wal-umrah. Jihadul Kabir, the old person, the da'if, the weak person, the mar'a, the woman, their jihad will be to go for Hajj and Umrah. So Hajj and Umrah is very blessed, and this is the jihad of the one who for some reason cannot participate in a legitimate jihad. Then this is the jihad that they should be eager to participate in, and that is the jihad of going for Hajj and Umrah. And also our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described a very big blessing for the Hajj and the Umrah, and it is a blessing that we should be very conscious of when we are performing the Umrah. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Al-hujjaju wal-ummaru wafdullahi ta'ala." The hujjaj and the ones doing Umrah, ummar are the ones doing Umrah, also called mu'tamir. Mu'tamir and ummar, the same thing. The hujjaj and the mu'tamir, they are wafdullah. Wafdullah means the guests of Allah, the delegates of Allah. They are the guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Da'ahum fa'ajabu. He called them and they were the ones who responded. So these are the ones who got the invitation cards. These are the ones that Allah called. So we say that those who go for Hajj and Umrah, it is as if Allah has called you. It's a special invitation and it's a blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed you to come and do the Hajj and Umrah. Da'ahum fa'ajabuhu wasa'aluhu fa'a'tahum. Therefore, if they ask Allah, Allah will then give them. So because Allah invited them, if they ask Allah, Allah will give them. And this is, subhanAllah, one of us who is generous. If a guest comes to our house and he wants something, we bend over backwards, we give him the best food. If a guest comes from out of town, we give him the best entertainment and whatnot. And Allah Azza wa Jal is Al-Kareem and Allah is Al-Razaq. So can you imagine when Allah has invited delegates and Allah has invited guests, how will that host take care of his guests? Walillahi alhamd. And so we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the opportunity to go for Hajj and Umrah, because those people who go for Hajj and Umrah, they are the delegates of Allah. Wafdullah. How do you think Al-Kareem will take care of his guests? And what do you think will happen when the guest asks the host, and the host is Allah Jalla Jalaluhu? What do you think that host will give to that guest who is asking? And therefore, of the greatest blessings of Umrah is that it increases the acceptance of dua. of the greatest blessings of Umrah, that this is the time to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is a blessing, multiple blessings are combined. Of the blessings is number one, a travel. Any travel, it increases the blessings of dua. Any travel. Number two, it is a travel to the house of Allah, which is the best travel. And there's no travel better than this travel. Number three, the people doing Hajj and Umrah are called guests of Allah, and our Prophet explicitly said, so when these guests ask Allah, Allah will give them. فَإِذَا سَأَلُوهُ أَعْطَاهُمْ When they ask, they will be given. Number four, they have combined between the positive of their state and the positive of their place and location. Their state is they are in Ihram, they're in Safar, they're doing an act of worship, and then their location, which is the Kaaba, which is the holiest place on earth. So they have combined between the best place and the best status. Now one thing is missing, that is the best time, that is combined during Hajj. And that's why the Hujjaj are level higher. And the best dua is the dua of the Hajj. Hajj. The one who makes Hajj, that is the highest level of dua, because he's combined between the state and the time and the place. However, the guy who's doing Umrah has two of the three, and that is the state and the place, and of course the time is any time of the year, alhamdulillah, that is good, but he doesn't get the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, which is of course the best time of the year. In any case, the point being that of the blessings of Hajj and Umrah is that the Hajj and the Mu'tamir, they are the guests of Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has invited them. And so therefore, whatever dua they ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is given to them. Now I want to go over briefly. So the Umrah of Ramadan, there are a number of authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that Umratun fi Ramadan ta'dilu hajjah. And this is narrated in the Musnad al-Bazzar, and I think Sahih ibn Khuzaima, if I'm not mistaken. Umratun fi Ramadan ta'dilu hajjah. That an Umrah in the month of Ramadan is equivalent to a Hajj. And in one version, a woman came to the Prophet and complained that her husband went for Hajj with him, but he couldn't take her, he couldn't afford to take her. So she complained that my husband left me, he couldn't take me, and I wanted to go with you. So the Prophet said that Umratun fi Ramadan ta'dilu hajjatan ma'i. That if you were to go for Umrah in Ramadan, any Ramadan, you will get the rewards of a Hajj with me. And some scholars have said this is a special gift to this woman, and some have made it generic to anybody who does Umrah in Ramadan, and we leave it to the generosity of Allah. But the hadith that says Umratun fi Ramadan ta'dilu hajjah, this is open and it's not restricted to this woman. So the blessings of getting a Hajj done will be given to the one who does Umrah in Ramadan, and that is a blessing for those who are able to go for Umrah in Ramadan. Maybe next year, inshallah, Danish, what do you think, huh? Next year, Umrah in Ramadan, MIC, you guys ready? Next year we'll do inshallah in Ramadan. Inshallah, we'll see. In any case, so what we wanted to do is, inshallah, go over the basics of the fiqh of Umrah, the basics of the fiqh of Umrah, so that we understand what we need to do and be prepared for any problems or any issues that might arise in the manasik or in the rites of Umrah. Okay, let us begin. We always begin fiqh with talking about the arkan and wajibat. That's the basics of fiqh. You need to know what is a rukun, what is a wajib. Now, to reiterate, and I've done this in many fiqh classes, but just to refresh our memory, a rukun is an essential pillar. Without it, the building collapses. If you don't have a rukun, you don't have the building. If you miss a rukun, there's nothing you can do to make it up. The building will collapse, right? So the rukun is an essential, necessary part of any ritual. For example, the Fatiha is a rukun of the salah. If you're praying by yourself, the Fatiha is a rukun. You cannot have the salah without the Fatiha. The sajda is a rukun. If you don't do sajda, you leave the sajda, you can't do anything to make it up. So, what are the arkan of Umrah? Umrah has three arkan. Very simple. Three arkan. Number one, ihram. Number two, tawaf. Number three, sa'i. Simple. You need to have these three in order for the Umrah to be the bare minimum complete. Ihram, tawaf, and sa'i. And we'll talk about each of these inshallah as we go along. The wajibat, what is the difference between rukun and wajib? The difference between rukun and wajib, if you miss a wajib, you're missing something that the building is still there, but it's incomplete, so you need to make it up by putting another pillar, or not a pillar, but another kafara, basically, right? So a wajib, if you miss a wajib, it's still complete, but you have to make up. You have to do a kafara. And the umrah has two wajibat. The umrah has two wajibat. The first of these is to enter into the ihram at the miqat. So, don't get confused. Being in ihram is a rukun. You have to be in ihram. But if you enter into ihram after the miqat, you have done the rukun but missed the wajib. Right? So it is wajib to enter into ihram at the miqat. What is the miqat? We'll talk about that. But you must enter into ihram at or before. By unanimous consensus, nobody says you have to enter right at that line. You have to enter before the miqat. Right? So if you enter even 10 minutes, 5 minutes before the miqat, not a problem. A few miles, 10 miles before the miqat. But you cannot pass the miqat without ihram. If you pass the miqat without ihram, then if you're able to go back, no problem. You just start again. But if you are not able to go back and you're zooming towards Mecca, then you make ihram for whenever you are able to make ihram, and you have to give a sacrifice because you missed the wajib, but you got the rukun because you were in ihram before you got for the tawaf, right? You have to be in ihram before you get to the tawaf, okay? So this is the first wajib, and that is ihram at the miqat. Don't get confused with ihram, that is rukun. Ihram at the miqat is wajib, clear? The second wajib is to shave or trim the hair. That is the wajib. If you don't do it, then it has to be made up with the dam. So you have to shave or trim the hair. And if you notice, the wajibat are beginning and end. The wajibat are basically what begins and ends the umrah, right? And then the arkan are right in the middle, which is tawaf, the ihram, the tawaf and sa'i, right? So the arkan, ihram, tawaf and sa'i, the wajibat, at the miqat you enter ihram, then you exit the ihram at the cutting of the hair or the shaving of the hair. That's the two wajibat. Everything else that I say after this, when I talk in detail, is sunnah. So if you do it, fine. If you don't do it, no sin upon you, and the umrah is completely valid, right? So these are the 5 points. If you do them, alhamdulillah, your umrah is valid, and you have basically done what is required of you. Now, let us begin. What is the miqat? The miqat are specific areas, 4 or 5 in number, difference of opinion, how many the Prophet ﷺ assigned, 4 or 5 in number. The Prophet ﷺ physically, he literally said that the miqat of Ahl Yemen, of the people of Yemen, is Yalamlam. The miqat of Medina is Dhul Hulayfa. The miqat of Najd is Qarn al-Manazil. He literally specified in a hadith, right? And then he said, "Hunna lahunna wa liman ata alayhinna min ghayri ahlihinna liman arada al-hajj wal-umrah." That these miqat are for those who live in these cities, Qarn al-Manazil, Yalamlam, "Hunna lahunna wa liman ata alayhinna min ghayri ahlihinna." And whoever comes through these cities, who are not residents of these cities, whoever wants to do umrah, he must, or liman arad al hajj wal umrah, whoever does hajj and umrah. So the miqat therefore are specific locations decided, demarcated by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And from this, the scholars have extrapolated a border. They have extrapolated a border. No scholar has ever said you have to go through one of these cities. Rather, there's a border given. And so in our times, you will find any road you take, it is impossible that you take a physical road unless you're in the desert with your camel. If you take any road by the highways, any road, the government has put a sign, the miqat is here, the miqat is coming. So it is impossible to miss the miqat if you are in a physical road. And if you're in an airplane, then the only miqat that you should be familiar, that you need to be familiar with, is the one that is outside of Jeddah, right? Pretty much the vast majority of scholars of our times have said Jeddah is within the miqat. So Medina is outside the miqat. So whoever is landing in Jeddah and then performing Umrah must wear ihram before landing by 5-10 minutes. Before the plane lands, before the plane actually gets, because the miqat of Jeddah is literally just outside the city. So the plane, as it is beginning its descent, that's when you will wear the ihram. That's when you will make the niyyah for the ihram. So this is for those who are going to Jeddah first and then Mecca. For us, in our particular group, we are going to Medina first. And Medina is outside the ihram, outside the miqat. So because Medina is outside the miqat, we don't have to worry about this issue. We will go to Medina first. We will wear our regular clothes over there. Then when we leave Medina, literally right outside of Medina, just by 20 minutes, right outside of Medina, there is that small little masjid of Dhul Hulayfa that the Prophet ﷺ said, for the people of Medina, the miqat is Dhul Hulayfa. And that Dhul Hulayfa is literally 20 minutes by car. And it is the farthest miqat from Mecca, by the way. The farthest miqat from Mecca is the one next to Medina. So those who are coming from Medina, they will pass by the miqat basically as they exit Medina. And generally speaking, the buses stop there and they allow people to basically wear the ihram and pray two rak'at and whatnot. And a very important point over here, that the praying of the two rak'ahs is not something that is related to the ihram. Rather, it is related to Dhul Hulayfa only. In other words, the Prophet ﷺ, he said that Jibreel came to me and commanded me to pray two rak'ahs in this valley. It is a blessed valley. The valley of Dhul Hulayfa is blessed. So when the Prophet ﷺ passed by Dhul Hulayfa, he was obviously putting his ihram on, so he prayed two rak'ahs because of Dhul Hulayfa. And some have misunderstood, or I should say there is an opinion. So one opinion is that this is extrapolated to all of the miqat, but the hadith says that Jibreel came and told me to perform two rak'ah because of Dhul Hulayfa. Therefore, for those of us who are, for some reason, if we're not going to Dhul Hulayfa, as for our group, we're going through Dhul Hulayfa. For those of us who are not going through Dhul Hulayfa, there is no concept of two rak'ah just for the ihram. That's not something that is narrated in the sunnah. But because we are going through Dhul Hulayfa, then we should pray two rak'ah if we stop at Dhul Hulayfa. And as far as I know, we are stopping in Dhul Hulayfa. Another point we need to understand, it is not at all necessary to stop at any of these miqat. You don't have to physically stop and then pray two rak'ah. The point is, before you pass through the miqat, you simply make the niyyah for ihram, and you are in the state of ihram. And you are in the state of ihram. Now, another important point. Now, this is going to really confuse many of you. Pay attention to this. What is the ihram when we talk about it from a fiqh perspective? We call the ihram the two garments that we wear. This is fine, you can call it whatever you want. But from a fiqh perspective, ihram is not the two garments. From a fiqh perspective, ihram is the declaration that you are performing Hajj and Umrah. Regardless of whether you're wearing your pant and shirt, your suit and tie, or your quote-unquote ihram, right? We call the garment ihram. This is vernacular, this is modern speech. From the shari'i perspective, ihram is the verbalization of the niyyah to perform Hajj and Umrah. Even if you're wearing pant and shirt, you can enter ihram. Now, understand this point. You can enter ihram in the state of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the eyes of Allah, by saying, Labbaik Allahumma Hajj, Labbaik Allahumma Umrah. Of course, we're not going to say Hajj, we're not doing Hajj, we're doing Umrah. For those who are entering Ihram for Hajj, they say Labbaik Allahumma Hajj. For us, we will say Labbaik Allahumma Umrah. That is our Ihram. Once we say the Labbaik, or we can even say, oh Allah, and if we want, we can say, oh Allah, I'm performing Umrah. Basically, we can say the Talbiyah, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik, any type of basically niyyah that we are performing the Hajj and Umrah, this is the ihram. Now, once we verbalize the ihram, automatically certain things become prohibited upon us. Of them is to wear pant and shirt, for example, right? So we should not technically wear a pant and shirt when we enter ihram. But suppose you're in a bus and you don't have your ihram with you, you're in a plane and the plane is landing in Jeddah, let's say, and you're going for Mecca. Suppose you're in a plane that your baggage got lost or whatever, or you forgot to put your ihram in your carry-on and you put it in your suitcase. And then you sat in the plane from, let's say, Lufthansa to Jeddah, and you forgot, oh my God, I don't have ihram, what am I going to do? I don't have a Hajj, it's a rukun, I have to... No, you see, this is the point here. You can simply say 5 minutes before landing in Jeddah, labbaik Allahumma hajj, let's say, if you're doing hajj, right? And you have entered into ihram, your pant and shirt is one of the mahdhurat, one of the mistakes that you're not supposed to do in ihram. You simply give fidya, 6 people or 3 days fasting or whatnot. This is the fidya. This is the kafara, right? Fidya is the proper term for breaking one of the things you shouldn't do in ihram, but you are in ihram if you say labbaik Allahumma hajj, right? Is that clear? I think I've confused some of you, but...
We don't have to give the dam.
So we'll get there. One of the ways you can do it is dam. One of the ways is dam, and one of the ways is feeding 6 people, and one of these is to fast 3 days. And you have equal choice of all three, right? And our scholars say there's no reason to put an extra burden on you. Paying a dam will cost you 500 riyals with $200 or something, whereas, you know, feeding 6 people will cost you $40, right? And there's no need to put an extra burden on yourself if Allah has allowed you equally. Allah clearly says you can do this or this or this. Anyone you want to do, you can do it. So again, what is the ihram? The ihram is the niyyah to do the hajj and umrah. That's what it is. And that niyyah, it is a rukun to have before the tawaf begins, and it is wajib to do at the miqat. Is that clear? Too much terms here, but inshallah, I hope it is clear, right? Okay, now with this, before we enter into ihram, there are certain sunnah. All of these are sunnah. As I said, besides these 5 things, anything I'll say is sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ would do a number of things before entering into ihram. He would take a bath. He would purify himself, take a bath, a full ghusl. And he even told women in their menses and postpartum bleedings to do ghusl, just to be a clean person, right? So even women who are in their menses, before they enter ihram, and by unanimous consensus, a woman in her menses can enter ihram. Doesn't matter what state you're in, you will enter ihram. So even a woman in her menses, it is sunnah for her to take a bath. And our Prophet ﷺ would put perfume on his body before entering ihram. Because once you enter ihram, you cannot put perfume. So he would put perfume before entering ihram on his body, not on his physical ihram. Right? So you put perfume on your body. And our scholars say that you should trim your nails and take care of your pubes and whatnot before this so that you don't have to worry. But this especially applies for Hajj when you have to do 3-4 days. For Umrah, you're just in 2 hours. But nonetheless, it is good to do this before you go on the journey. Also, in the state of Ihram, before you enter into Ihram, one should obviously be prepared to physically be dressed appropriately. And as for the men, as we know, their tailored garments are not allowed now. I mentioned in the Fiqh of Hajj, which I think many of you attended, there's a huge misconception around the world. What does it mean, tailored garments? And this misconception simply comes from a bad translation and a faulty understanding of the Arabic. Tailored garments does not mean a garment that has needlework done on it, right? This ihram has a lot of needlework done on it. This is not a tailored garment. Okay, any garment that you buy, basically, you will have tailor. There's tailor work done, and the corners have tailor work. The decoration, tailor work. This is not what is forbidden. What is meant by stitched garment? What is meant is any garment that covers a limb, shirt, jacket, pants, underwears, t-shirt. These cover a limb. They are made to fit a body part. This is what stitched and tailored means. So we have unstitched, which means things you wrap around. This is what is meant by unstitched. Not something that doesn't have a needle and thread, which is every garment that is manufactured in our times has some type of needle and thread. This is a common misconception, right? Untailored, unstitched, for the men obviously, it means that they will not be covering a limb. So anything that covers a limb, which is a shirt, or a pant, or an underwear, or a t-shirt, these things should not be worn in the state of ihram for men. Of course, for women, there is no ihram in the clothing. Nothing is forbidden for them. They wear what they wear before ihram and out after ihram. They don't have any ihram in their regular clothing, except for the niqab and the gloves. The only 2 things that the woman is not supposed to wear is the niqab and the gloves. For those sisters who wear gloves and niqab, so they have alternatives. They can get long sleeves and they can wear jilbab on top. And for those who don't wear niqab and gloves, which is the majority of our sisters here, they don't have to worry about this at all. They will just dress as they dress here. They will dress over there. Also, when the ihram has been entered into, it is sunnah to say the talbiyah as loud as you can for as long as you can. So much so that our Prophet said the best hajj is the hajj. Now this is hajj when qiyas for umrah. The best hajj is the hajj where the voices are raised and the throats become sore. With what? Talbiyah. That's the best hajj. Al-ajj wa thajj. That you raise the voices and your voices become sore. So you're always doing dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the best hajj. And the same goes for the umrah as well. That we're supposed to say labbaik Allahumma labbaik. It is a part of the etiquettes of the ihram that we say this as much as possible. And we say the talbiyah until we enter the Bayt al-Haram. That's when the talbiyah stops. Because now we've arrived. So then there's no point of saying the talbiyah once you arrive in the Bayt al-Haram. Not in Mecca. As the bus is driving through Mecca, you may continue to say the talbiyah. When you enter the Bayt al-Haram, which is the masjid area, that is when the talbiyah stops because now you've arrived. And that then changes into dua. Now, what are you not supposed to do during ihram? The same for hajj and umrah. So the exact same thing. What are you not supposed to do? I went over it in a lot of detail in hajj. I'll go over it very briefly for the umrah. Number one. Cutting or shaving the hair, any hair. Number one, cutting or shaving the hair. You're not supposed to cut or shave the hair. Number two, you're not supposed to trim the nails. تقليم الأظافر. You're not supposed to trim the nails. Number three, you're not supposed to put on perfume. And this means you wear something that is known as perfume and whose only sole purpose is perfume. As for creams, lotions, gels, soaps, toothpaste, we don't call these things perfumes in our modern culture. They might have some scent, but they are not perfumes. Nobody uses soap to perfume himself. Nobody brushes his teeth to perfume himself. So there's nothing wrong with using soaps and creams and lotions and gels that have a slight scent to them. Some scholars have said it is better to avoid just to get out of the karaha. But nobody, as I said, uses toothbrush to smell good. That's what we spray. That's what we have, deodorant, body deodorant. That's what we have that. So you may use, by the way, you get unscented body deodorant, by the way. Right? You may use unscented body deodorant. There's nothing wrong with using creams, lotions, and gels. The skin will get very dry. It's very hot over there, parched. Not a problem to use creams. And most creams have some scent to them. This is not perfume. Even though it is perfumed, it is not perfume. Right, so there's nothing wrong with using these types of things, because what has been forbidden is what you put on yourself as perfume. And this is the cologne or any type of perfume that we wear. This has not been allowed during the ihram.
There were young kids who were having these perfumes that they would put on the people, and they would not like discriminate somebody is having a hand. What is there?
If somebody puts perfume on you and you tried your best to get out, you are forgiven. I mean, nothing is not, but you go and you simply wash it. And this is not correct for people to put perfume on others with ihram. It is not correct to do this. The kids think they might be doing something good by giving perfume out. They should be taught. This is not what needs to be done in the state of ihram. So this is the number.
You can also get unperfumed things in Saudi. You
can get unperfumed lotions and whatnot in Saudi. But obviously it is better if you get it from here, because you don't want the hassle of trying to find something over there. But if you forget, because this is fiqh, I mean, everybody knows this, the local pharmacies in Mecca and Medina, they always sell these types of things. So you can just walk in and get those types of unscented things. So the number three we said is perfume. Number four, not related to us, hunting. We're not going to get into the fiqh of hunting, but we don't have to hunt in the state of ihram. Number five, we already said wearing stitched garments. And I explained what is stitched garments, and that is only for men. Number six, wearing a garment over the hair, covering the head for men again. A direct attachable garment over the head. So a kufi, a turban, an imama, a ghutra, anything that is attached to the head, it should also be avoided. Anything that is distanced from the head is not relevant. For example, an umbrella, that's not a problem. An umbrella is not a problem. It is authentically narrated that Bilal ibn Abi Rabah would shade the Prophet ﷺ in the state of Ihram. He would be sitting down and Bilal would be standing and just shading him. Nothing wrong. He would sit under a shelter. And so we had no problems with a shade that is not connected. But what is not allowed is to be connected. And then for women, we have wearing the niqab and the gloves. This is for women. They're not supposed to wear the niqab and the gloves. Now, for any of these that we have done, other than hunting, let's not talk about hunting. For any of these, people go to extremes. And they consider, for example, if a person, his hair falls out, for example, that he has to give a kafara. And this is fanaticism. The Sharia has prohibited cutting the hair. But every human sheds hair every day of his life. And it is impossible for a few days to go by without a hair falling out, right? Or your nail just hits something and it gets cracked. This is not, you didn't cut it. And this is extremism and fanaticism. Say, oh my God, I have a quarter nail cut, I have to give a kafara. This is fanaticism. So much so that our scholars say that if your nail got scraped and it's dangling, you're allowed to intentionally cut that bit off. Because you cannot, as we all know, it's irritating to have that nail dangling there. This was beyond your control. It got chipped, so you just chipped the rest of it off. Not a problem. What would be mahzoor, what would not be allowed, would be to physically trim nails and to shave or trim the beard or the hair on top. Otherwise, combing in and of itself is not of the mahdurat. It's not of the things that are prohibited. Even if combing might give one or two hairs out, but there's no prohibition against combing. The prohibition is against shaving or trimming. So there's nothing wrong with combing the hair. If any a person does these things intentionally, or there's a reason to do so, in those days lice would be a big problem, right? And there's an authentic hadith of the Sahabi who had lice, and the Prophet ﷺ said, and he thought it was khalas, haram to do anything, and his lice was infesting his head. The Prophet ﷺ said, Subhanallah, may Allah have mercy on you. Go shave your hair and give the kafara. You know, you have a legitimate excuse, go shave your hair off and then give the kafara. So if a person has a legitimate excuse, so for example, let me just say in our times, very common, somebody has some type of, let's say, now especially when Hajj is in the cold season, has some pneumonia, something sensitive, they have to wear a jacket in Muzdalifah, in Mina, it's too cold for them. And the doctor is saying that protect your chest, whatnot. For these people, we say, wear the jacket and give the kafara. Just like the Sahabi who had the lice on his hair, that if you have a legitimate reason, then you are forgiven. If you don't have a legitimate reason, you have committed a sin and you have to give kafara. The only difference, legitimate, illegitimate, is the sin issue. If you have a reason, you're not sinful, you give the kafara. If you don't have a reason, you're sinful, ask Allah to forgive you and you give a kafara as an expiation. So, an intentional cutting or trimming or putting on perfume. If it's unintentional, for example, as we just said, a person just put perfume on you. Or you're going through your belongings, you saw the perfume, subconsciously you put it on you, and then you put it back. You say, oh my God, I put perfume on. This is unintentional. You go, you wash it off, and you're forgiven. Because anything that's done unintentionally, anything that's done without qas, without niyyah, it is forgiven, so not a problem. Other things that are forbidden, inshallah, we don't have to worry about during the Umrah trip. I hope nobody is going for the Umrah to give a proposal to somebody during the Umrah trip. So this is not also allowed, the khutbah. You can give khutbah, but not khutbah, okay? You can give khutbah. I will be giving khutbahs, but definitely not khutbahs, don't worry. So khutbahs is a lecture. Khutbah is the proposal. So during the Umrah, during the Ihram, I should say, during Ihram, you cannot give khutbah. And according to the strongest position, some even said that the khutbah is not accepted. It's not a valid proposal, but there's an ikhtilaf. In any case, inshallah, we don't have to worry about this issue. And then, the other two things related to intimacy with one spouse, and the both of them are related to being physical. So the first of these is to be romantic without being intimate, without getting to the actual act itself, and this is a problem, and some have said that some type of fidya must be given, and what the fidya is, there's a bit of a controversy over. And then the other issue, which is really the one that breaks the ihram in a very severe manner, and that is the actual act of intimacy during the state of ihram. This is considered to be a major sin. You have really violated the purpose and the spirit of the ihram, and therefore this basically makes the umrah null and void, or the hajj null and void. and you must continue doing the Hajj and Umrah even though it's not going to count. And then you must make it up the next year, and you must give a huge kafara of a cow or a camel or something, so it's a big penalty, a big sin, definitely, inshallah, it's not the time now to engage in these things in the state of ihram. Now obviously, these are only during the state of ihram. Only during the state of ihram. And so for umrah, the state of ihram will last a few hours for us. For hajj, it will last us 3 days. Right? For Umrah, it will last us a few hours. We will enter Umrah in Dhul Hulayfa. It will take us 4 or 5 hours to get to Mecca. And then in Mecca, it will take us 2 hours. So I hope that in these 6-7 hours, inshallah, we can avoid these things, inshallah ta'ala. It is not a problem. Outside of Ihram, all of these things are allowed. All of them, without any ishkal, without any problem. Outside of these things, all are allowed. As for, so these are the mahdhurat. Now let's begin with the tawaf and sa'i. The big controversy about the tawaf is regarding the issue of wudu. Must you have wudu in order to do tawaf or not? Must you have wudu in order to do tawaf or not? This is a big controversy. The Shafi'is, the Malikis, and the Hanbalis, they say that having wudu is a shart. Which means if you don't have wudu, you're not doing tawaf. It's like salah. And the Hanafis say it is wajib, which means you really should, but if you don't do it, you can make it up with a dam. And Ibn Taymiyyah said it is sunnah. It's not even wajib or shart, it's sunnah. So if you don't have wudu, your tawaf is accepted, right? And there's a big controversy amongst the scholars, which we went over, by the way, in the Fiqh of Wudu. For those of you who attended the Fiqh of Wudu, I spent an entire seminar on this ikhtilaf and the evidences. Now is not the time to get into that. The bottom line, it's only one tawaf that'll take you 25 minutes. Please get out of the controversy and do wudu, right? Just do wudu and get out of the controversy. Have your wudu. And therefore, according to those madhahib, all four madhahib, if you break your wudu during tawaf, you need to go back, do wudu, start tawaf again. And according to Ibn Taymiyyah, you are forgiven, meaning it's not even forgiven, it's not an issue. Personally, I lean towards Ibn Taymiyyah's position. It's very authentic, it's very solid. Nonetheless, subhanAllah, just to be on the safe side, and just to keep with the spirit and whatnot, just do wudu before you do tawaf. Do wudu and then keep that wudu. By the way, none of the scholars has ever said that you need wudu for the sa'i. By unanimous consensus, sa'i, you don't need to have wudu. So sa'i is a separate rukun. You don't need to have wudu for the sa'i. The controversy is over the tawaf, not over the sa'i. The sa'i has nothing to do with the wudu. So after the tawaf, if you need to break your wudu, you break your wudu and you continue the sa'i. Right? If you ask my opinion, then you don't start. The question is, if you break your wudu in the middle of the tawaf, do you start from the very beginning of the tawaf, or do you start from just the round that you broke your wudu in, right? In my humble opinion, I follow Ibn Taymiyyah's fatwa actually in this regard, so I don't believe you really need to start over again anyway. Because, we're getting into evidences here, but our Prophet ﷺ, over 100,000 people performed the Hajj. 100,000 people. And he did not ever hint or say that, oh people, have wudu before you perform the Hajj, before you perform the Umrah. And it is impossible for this large gathering to have known this ruling before they come. And our Prophet ﷺ would not have kept silent about this if it were a necessary condition. And therefore, I follow the position of Ibn Taymiyyah. I'm just saying, to be on the safe side, do wudu. But if you happen to break your wudu, this is the position that also my own teacher, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, and others, many of our scholars, they also held this position. The evidences are very strong for it. But the majority of scholars, again, the issue is you're going for Hajj, you're going for Umrah. They want to make it seem spiritually better. It's a human nature, you know. You want to make it better. So khalas, make it better. But if you follow the majority position, then most scholars would say you need to start your tawaf from the beginning again. Because tawaf is one connected act of worship. It's not seven connected acts of worship, it is one connected act of worship. That is tawaf. And therefore, if you break your wudu and you're following the other madahib, then you will begin the tawaf from the beginning. Right? But nonetheless, if you ask me, then it doesn't break the wudu in any case. So, we all know that tawaf begins with the black stone, the Hajj al-Aswad, and it finishes at the black stone. So everybody knows this. There's a line there these days. There's a green light. All of this is well known. That's where the crowd.
No line anymore.
Oh yeah, that's right. They had taken the line out. Yes.
And which is good.
Which is much better, actually. Yes, you're absolutely right. They took it out my last year. So that's why psychologically, yeah. But they have the green light. They have the green light. And it's pretty clear where it is. So, again, you don't have to be exact on that line, but basically when you get there, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would try his best to kiss the black stone. He would try his best to kiss the black stone, and if he wasn't able to kiss it, he would touch it. If he wasn't able to touch it, he would have a stick, and he would touch it with the stick. And if you cannot even do that, you simply make a motion. All of this is sunnah. If you don't do anything, your rukun and wajib has been done. Remember, all of these things that we're adding is sunnah. So, for the bulk of us who are not able to kiss the black stone or to touch it physically, so we'll simply say the takbir, Allahu Akbar, and make a motion towards the black stone, and the stronger position does appear to be, even though it's a trivial matter, but the takbir is done with the right hand only, that you don't face the black stone and say Allahu Akbar as most of the hujjaj do. That's the takbir of the salah. Right, this is the takbir of the salah. It is not narrated that the Prophet ﷺ stopped, turned, faced the black stone, and then said, Allahu Akbar, this is for the salah. And so many people, they kind of want to do that. Rather, you simply face the black stone as you are walking, you turn, and you just say, Allahu Akbar, and then you move on. You're not supposed to stop the crowd, and that's what most people do, is that they stop the crowd. That goes against logic and common sense, and there's nothing narrated from the sunnah that demonstrates this. So it is sunnah to say, Allahu Akbar, and then move on. Also, the other two rukuns, by the way, there's no sunnah about the other two rukuns. Then the rukun yamani, which is before the black stone, our Prophet ﷺ tried to, he would usually touch it as well. And he said that touching the rukun yamani causes your sins to fall down. So it causes your sins to basically be discarded. So if you're able to do that, fine. If you cannot touch the rukun yamani, there is no ishara to the rukun yamani. There is no pointing to the rukun yamani. Rukun yamani, either you touch it or you don't. If you don't touch it, you just move on. Right? If you don't touch it, you just move on. Also, by the way, if you're able to touch the rukun yamani, you're supposed to touch it with your right hand, because all things are touched with the right hand, not with the left. And so this means that when you get to the rukun yamani, you will literally have to turn and touch it, because the rukun yamani is on your left hand. Right? So when you get there, you will literally have to turn and touch it and then move on. My advice, if you're first time performing tawaf, to not worry about the rukun yamani or the Hajj Aswad. Inshallah, you'll have plenty more tawafs in the 4 or 5 days that we're there, that you're concentrating just on the tawaf, right? Right now, you want to concentrate on the ibadat and the dhikr and whatnot. Now, as for the adhkar of tawaf, there has been nothing narrated from our Prophet ﷺ about what he would say, except for between rukun yamani and Hajj Aswad, he would say, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. That's the only thing that has been narrated. The rest of the tawaf, there has been nothing narrated. Now you get these booklets and pamphlets that people sell you that's full of adhkar. And the reason people do this, I guess to make a buck as well, but also so that you keep busy. And there's I understand some wisdom. At the same time, it is problematic when you read something and you have no idea what is on that piece of paper. You're not doing an ibadah. It is far better that you take a Quran and you read it with you. Or you just say, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha Allahu Akbar, right? Or you make your own du'as. So you do something that will keep you spiritual. You do something that will keep you connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I would not encourage anybody to be carrying a book around that they have no clue what it means. Now, if you know what it means and you want to read some specific du'as, so for example, all of us have gotten that book, The Fortress of the Believer, Hisn al-Muslim, right? This is one of the best books that Allah has really written barakah for on this earth. It's a very good book. Go over it before you get to Mecca. Go over it before you get to Mecca and Medina. Circle those du'as that really move you. And then have it in your tawaf, and then just say it, because it's a dua that the Prophet ﷺ said. It's better than just doing nothing. Or you can do dhikr, or you can read the Quran, But whatever you do, take advantage of that time by connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And obviously, don't waste your time, astaghfirullah, gossiping or chit-chatting. We're not, our Prophet said that the tawaf around the Kaaba is like the salah, except that Allah has allowed talking. So whoever speaks, let him speak good. So Allah has allowed you to speak, right? So, you know, you can call out to your kid, you're like, come here, you're going far away. It's okay, it's not like the salah. Okay, it's not a problem. Or you can tell your wife, okay, when we finish, we'll meet over there. You can tell your wife this, not a problem. But whoever wants to speak, our Prophet said, let him speak with khayr, with good. So obviously, I don't need to remind you, but I mean, astaghfirullah, but when you get there, you will see. There are people, they answer their cell phones around the tawaf, you know. Literally, I have seen this, and I'm sorry to tell you, you are going to see it as well. Okay, their phone rings, and then, hello, oh yeah, I'm just doing tawaf, what's going on, you know? It's like, subhanAllah, yeah, no, we'll do this business. I mean, they talk stuff, and astaghfirullah, this is the reality of people. You know, you just do your job, you let them do theirs. You do what you have to do, and Allah will deal with them. So again, I mean, the point is that it's easier for us who go once in every few years. For those who go regularly, the fact of the matter is, even tawaf becomes a routine. This is the fact. Even tawaf and umrah becomes, yeah, regular, once a week, once every 2 weeks they'll come. They don't have that same respect, haybah, that same, you know, ihtiram that we would have if we're coming once a year. And this is the reality of anything that is done repetitively. Now, also when you finish the tawaf, by the way, when you finish the seventh round, our Prophet ﷺ did not make the ishara, because the ishara is done for the beginning of the tawaf, not at the end. So if you were to make the ishara, you'll make it eight. Think about it. If you were to touch the black stone or whatnot, you would make it eight. And that's not what he did. He would do it at the beginning. So when you finish the seventh, khalas, you are done. The rukun is finished. And the sunnah of our process, and again, all of this is sunnah, is to pray two raka'ah behind the maqam Ibrahim, and to recite the verse وَاتَّخِذُوا مِن مَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلَّى, which says, take the maqam Ibrahim as a place of salah, and then you go and you pray two rak'ats over there, the first of which you read Surah Qul Ya Al-Kafirun, and the second is Surah Al-Ikhlas. So you read these two rak'ah behind the maqam Ibrahim, and if you're not able to pray at maqam Ibrahim, you pray anywhere. And if you don't pray anywhere, then you have missed a sunnah, but your umrah is completely valid. Now frankly, in our times, it is, our scholars, my own teachers have said, it is against the sunnah to pray behind maqam Ibrahim when you are going to cause tawaf problems. Because the greater sunnah is to allow the flow of traffic. And we see ignorant overzealousness that somebody's going to pray right behind maqam Ibrahim and stop all of the traffic there. And this is not a part of the sunnah. So if you're not going to find a place over there, go somewhere else to pray. Go in the back somewhere, pray two raka'ah. And after this, our Prophet ﷺ took a little bit of a break by drinking zamzam. And so if you want to drink zamzam at this time, to follow really literally what the Prophet ﷺ did, alhamdulillah, that is great. And if you want to go directly, that is fine as well. So you drink zamzam. And by the way, now is a good time to just mention one or two ahadith about Zamzam. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Zamzam is ta'amu tu'min wa shifa'u suqmin. That Zamzam is the food of the one who needs food and the cure of the one who has any disease. Ta'amu tu'min wa shifa'u suqmin. That anybody who has a disease, the Zamzam will cure that disease. And there are mutawatir stories that everybody has heard of and knows, and I have heard myself from my own friends and whatnot, that Zamzam has cured them of multiple sicknesses and whatnot. And this is something that our Prophet ﷺ said, the most blessed water on earth is Zamzam. The most barakah is Zamzam. And honestly, we don't even, just the very fact that for 4,000 years, a well in the middle of the desert, from Allah knows where this water comes from, millions upon millions of people are drinking and taking water around the globe, right? And we buy Zamzam even here in Memphis, even anywhere we go to the halal supermarkets and they're selling those canisters of Zamzam. Where is Zamzam spread? And yet that well is still producing water. It is enough of a miracle for us. So we don't need to know anything else. It is enough of a miracle. There is barakah in that water. And our Prophet ﷺ said, "Ma uzamzama lima shuriba lahu." Ma uzamzama lima shuriba lahu. That the water of Zamzam will give you whatever you drank it for. Which means it is sunnah to make dua before you drink Zamzam. For every sip, for every time you drink Zamzam, you make a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so of the times that dua is accepted more is when you drink Zamzam. So you make your dua to Allah and then you take that sip of Zamzam. And of course it is sunnah to drink small sips, so you increase the barakah as well of the Zamzam. So all of this can be done at any time, but if you want to be very much in the sunnah, our Prophet drank Zamzam between tawaf and sa'i. He drank Zamzam between tawaf and sa'i. Then after you have finished the tawaf, you then go to do the sa'i. And the sa'i, by the way, the sa'i is technically not inside of the Kaaba area. And that is why, I don't know if anybody here would remember this, but back in the 70s, this even I did not catch this when I was a child, back in the mid 70s, and before this for the last 14 centuries, you would have to physically exit the haram to enter the sa'i area. Any of you caught this? None of you went in that time? We have one of our brothers, Khan Sahab, the elderly man, Umar Khan Sahab, yeah, mashallah. He would tell you all of these stories as well from that era. And this was from the most of the Muslim history, by the way. So, you know, most of Islamic history, you would physically have to exit the haram area to enter the sa'i area. The sa'i area is not a part of the haram area. And this also helps you understand wudu is not a requirement in during the sa'i. And our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would then go to the sa'i area and climb Safa. And he would say, I will begin with what Allah began with, because Allah has said, and he would recite, Inna Safa wal Marwata min Sha'a'irillah, faman hajjal bayta aw i'tamara fala junaha alayhi an yatawafa bihima. So he said, I will begin with what Allah began with, and Allah began with Safa. So Inna Safa wal Marwa. Now in our times you can only begin with Safa because the crowd is, they made it that way. But once upon a time when you would exit, you could have gone to both. But now the way that they made it, you have to go to Safa first anyway. So our process would begin with Safa, and his sunnah was to climb up Safa, but by unanimous consensus, you don't have to climb the mountain. You can just touch the base of the mountain. And in our times, this is indicated by the slope being inclined upwards. So, and this is especially useful for those who are elderly and weak, and for those who have a wheelchair, that you don't have to push, if you're pushing your mother or your father, you don't have to push all the way to the top. You don't have to do that. And you will see many of the people, they will just get to the bottom of the mountain and then turn around. That's fine and legit. Not a problem at all, because they have touched the mountain. As long as they get to Safa. And in our times, as I said, it's very clear where it begins, because the gradient, the plane begins like this. So our Prophet would go to the top and he would stand at Safa and face the Kaaba and see the Kaaba. Now in our times, it's very difficult to see the Kaaba. You have to find in between all of the pillars, and you know, if you can find it, alhamdulillah. If not, then don't, yani, you know, don't make this a thing to ruin it. It's just something that he would do in those days. And he would make a long dua. He would make a dhikr, Allahu Akbar, Alhamdulillah, alladhi, Subhanallah, La ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika la, نصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب نصر عبده وأعز جنده وهزم الأحزاب وحده لا إله إلا الله ولا نعبد إلا إياه مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون. He would say these types of adhkar, and then he would make long du'as standing at Safa and at Marwa, both of them, right? So this is of the sunnahs. If you want to do this, alhamdulillah, good. So these are times to make du'as in. And by the way, just as a point of benefit here, it really breaks the monotony of walking. Because it is human nature, when you're walking, you're not going to be thinking so much of du'as and whatnot. So it's very good when you get to the end, you actually take a 5-minute pause. And you increase your khushu' and spirituality by making du'a to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And long du'as, he would make a long du'a at Safa and at Marwa, both times facing the Kaaba. So, and we all know that from Safa to Marwa is one, from Marwa to Safa is two. Some innocent people, they say Safa to Marwa and back to Safa is one. No faqih says this. This is a common misconception. This is innocent people, they think all the way back. So they do 14 rounds. And, you know, they may Allah reward them, but this is wrong. I mean, for their intention, I mean. But it is wrong, and knowledge will teach you this is incorrect. So you do the 7 times between Safa and Marwa. And our mother Hajar, as we know, the story goes that when Ismail was alone, that in between Safa and Marwa there were two mountains and there was a valley that went beneath, that she would have to go beneath the valley and Ismail was hidden from her. So when she got to this valley, she would run quickly so that she could keep a physical eye on her child Ismail, right? And so in that valley she would run to get to the other side. And forever this tradition has kept alive, and our Prophet Muhammad ﷺ kept it alive as well. And in the days of Jahiliyyah, there would be two markers. In our times we have the green poles and lights, right? So that has still been kept alive to this time, that to this day, for the men, obviously women don't have to run, and they should not run, it is for the men only. For the men, they're supposed to run, and by run, we don't mean you're running the Olympic race here, you know, it just means like you're just running a little bit to show the spirit of our mother Hajar. And obviously, now I didn't go into this tangent because time is limited, but every single step of the way, you're supposed to think of Ibrahim and Ismail and Hajar, you're supposed to remember their sacrifices, their spirituality, the trust that Hajar had. When she said to Ibrahim, "Did Allah tell you to leave us alone?" And he said, "Yes." So she said, "Okay, go, Allah will take care of me. Allah will take care of us." That tawakkul that she had. And she's running between the mountains, her baby's dying of thirst. All of these should come in your image. This is exactly where it happened. Right? This is exactly where all of that happened. That iman, that sabr, that tawakkul. You're following the footsteps of thousands and thousands of years. Millions, I would say billions of people have done this by now. And you are a part of that ummah from the time of Ibrahim up until our time. So you finish all of these seven between Safa and Marwa. Then when you get to the very end and you will finish at Marwa. Because 1, 2, 3, 4, so you finish up at 7 over there. When you finish 7, once again you don't do takbir or standing or dua, because that's the end. The dua is done at the beginning. So you end, and at the end you are supposed to, of course, either trim or shave the hair. And in Hajj, the Prophet ﷺ basically said that shaving has 3 times the reward of trimming, so we expect the same for Umrah as well. So for those of you who are able to, I strongly encourage you to shave the hair, because it is a sign of humility. Now ask yourself, why do you not want to shave the hair? The response is, you want to look good. Correct, right? That's the whole point. It's exactly the point. You sacrifice something trivial for the sake of humility. Get that vainness, get that ego, clamp it down, right? So you shave your hair so that you are expressing tawadu, humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But by the way, I mean, don't take me too harshly. If you want to just trim, that's fine. There's no sin. It is allowed. And we're not going to make the sharia more difficult than what Allah has made. And this is the mercy of Allah. Halqan taqsir is that. Now, important point here. Some madhahib have allowed, and this is an opinion of one of the madhahib, it's not even the standard position, that you just take 2 or 3 locks of hair from here and there. I am very strongly opposed to this position. And I don't consider, I think this is a type of trick. It's a type of, what are you going to call it? You know, wheezing your way out. You know, this is really not the goal of the sharia. You know, the Prophet ﷺ, Allah is, you're supposed to trim or shave. And if you go to the barber and the barber takes, okay, click, 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 khalas, give me $20. You would say, what, you haven't trimmed, you haven't done anything. Why should I pay you? You would complain if the barber does to your hair what you're doing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You would do this, right? In my humble, and I'm very strict about this, I don't think that this is permissible. Now, for those who follow that position or whatnot, that's between you and Allah. You ask me, I say this is playing with the sharia. And this is not even the majority position of even that madhab. This is one position one scholar has held. Don't follow, you know, the easy positions and opinions. I don't agree with this. So my point is that you really should shave or trim. Now, if you want to shave, be careful when you go to the barber. Most barbers will use the machine. And if they use the machine, that's not shaving. So you need to tell them, no, I want shave. You say halq. I don't want taqseed, halq, right? Actually, why am I saying halq? 99% of Pakistani. So mashallah, you just say, nay bhai sahab, ye nahi kari, mushkur. You know, just, what do you say shave in Urdu? Ganja gara dije, bilkul, exactly. Ganja gara dije, you know? And they're all Pakistanis there, mashallah, subhanAllah, don't worry. So the point is just be careful, because they just want to do a quick job. Right? Because I have a long line, so they just use the machine on you. And you say, no, I don't want the machine. You know, and they charge $5 more, I mean, $2 more. You know?
Huh? They'll be going out and getting you, pulling you out.
Yeah, that's true, actually. Yeah. The price is, yeah, I mean, but between dollars, I mean, it's a few dollars more. I mean, it's not a big deal, you know. So you tell them that I want the shave, you know, I want to, you know. They all use clean razor, by the way. I mean, I have been there for 20 years of my life. Never once have I seen a barber use the same razor twice. But nonetheless, you can monitor, but they're good about this. They do this. In any case, so if you're able to shave, alhamdulillah, if you trim, then that's fine. And it's up to you if you want to just have a trim. You can use the machine, or they can do the scissors and comb like you do it over here. That is fine. And once you do this, then of course you are out of ihram completely. That all of the ihram has finished, and therefore you are now finished from the state of ihram. One final point. I know we're getting late here, but this is very important. One final point, and then we'll open questions. Let's ladies here. Our Prophet ﷺ instructed the ladies to basically cut the fingers length of the hair from their braids. So if the sister has braids, which was the case in the past, most of them had it, she would just take that braid and then trim a little bit of it. If she does not have braids, if she's free-flowing hair under her hijab, she will basically gather it in a bun, she will gather it whatever she can, and then the very tip of it she can cut just a finger's length, and that will constitute moving out of the ihram. I'm going to leave time for Q&A, but there's one point that I really do need to discuss, and that is the issue of multiple umrahs. The issue of multiple umrahs, all of you guys ask about this, that I've come all the way from America and we're there in Mecca for 4 or 5 days. Why can't we do 2 umrahs, 3 umrahs, 5 umrahs? Let us go do every day, let us go do an umrah, right? So can you do multiple umrahs per trip? The scholars have differed about this issue. And the Shafi'i and Hanafi position is that yes, you can unconditionally do as many umrahs as you're physically capable of doing. So if you spend the entire day going back and forth between Tan'im, or what is called Masjid Aisha, and the Haram, and you do, mashallah, tabarakallah, 10 umrahs, more better for you. This is the Shafi'i and the Hanafi position. And they base it on the simple fact that, look, Umrah is an act of worship, and the more acts of worship you do, the better it is. So they have some point. And they also say that in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, Aisha was in her menses, she entered Ihram in the menses, she was not able to do Umrah. And she had to wait until she finished the menses, and then she was in Arafat and Muzdalifah and Mina. Then she finished and she did her tawaf, only tawaf and sa'i, and then she came back and she started crying and she said, O Messenger of Allah, everybody has done Umrah and Hajj, and I've only done a Hajj, I haven't done Umrah. So the Prophet ﷺ told her brother, Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr, he told her brother that take her to, it's called Tan'im, they now call it Masjid Aisha. Now Tan'im, what is Tan'im? Mecca itself has a sacred land, which is Haram. And this is a small area, just Mecca. Broader than this is the circle of Miqat. Broader than this is the circle of Miqat. Those who are living in Mecca, they simply have to go outside of the Haram of Mecca. It's called the Hill. Then they put the Ihram on. So those who are living in Mecca or happen to be in Mecca, if they want to perform another Umrah for some reason, they simply have to get out of the sacred boundaries of the Haram. They don't have to go to the Miqat. They simply go out of the Haram area. So there's two circles. There's the Haram of Mecca, then there's the Miqat circle. And the Haram of Mecca, their fiqh rulings apply. As we said, you can't pluck trees, no weapons. All of those rulings apply. That's the Haram, not from the Miqat, that's from the Haram. So those who are in Mecca, they exit Mecca and they go to the, it's called the Hill area. And the closest hill from the Haram is Tan'im, which is called Masjid Aisha. By car, it's 10 minutes. It's the closest hill. And you can go to any hill, you can go to any area of hill. So, our Prophet ﷺ told Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr and Aisha to go to Tan'im, and then she did an Umrah, he did an Umrah because he was with her, and then the two of them rejoined the Prophet ﷺ and went on. From this, the Hanafis and Shafi'is, they say, why can't we do it like Aisha? Let us do multiple Umrahs, okay? And they say, okay, Aisha didn't do multiple, Abdurrahman did multiple, because he was accompanying. Abdurrahman did the first time and he did it again with Aisha. The Hanbalis, they said, Imam Ahmad said, that multiple umrah should only be done, now listen to this, after your hair has grown back. Because he said that the purpose of shaving the hair is to show humility and ibadah. So he said a week, 10 days, 2 weeks. So when you have some hair again, then it is mustahab. Otherwise, it's not mustahab. So he gave it some time, right? So basically, for a 5-day trip, the Hanbali madhab would not encourage double umrahs, right? He would say, if you're there for many months, every few weeks you go and do umrah. This is what the Hanbali position is. Ibn Taymiyyah's position was, the Maliki position. The Maliki position, Imam Malik said, umrah should not be done more than once a year. Why? Listen to this. He said, because doing multiple umrahs cheapens the umrah. You lose the luster, the excitement of the umrah. So the Maliki said it's makruh to do more than one umrah a year. Keep it rare so that you appreciate the umrah. Right? And Ibn Taymiyyah's position, which has been the position of many of my own teachers, is that it is makruh to do more than one umrah per trip. Because he said our Prophet ﷺ did one umrah per trip every time. Even though he stayed in Mecca for so many days, but he only did one umrah at the beginning and that's it. And he has the same position as Imam Malik, Ibn Taymiyyah, and he says that multiple umrahs cheapens the umrah. Multiple umrahs loses the respect and the excitement that umrah should have. And so you should concentrate on the umrah that you're doing. And then next time trip you come, you do umrah. Now, they're all the positions therefore, right? You have all the positions from one to the other. In my humble opinion, and Allah knows best, no doubt my heart always gravitates towards Ibn Taymiyyah. You know, I admire him immensely and always his points are logical. But I'd like to add a caveat, a little bit of an exception here. If somebody has a legitimate need to do another umrah, then I don't see it a problem if they do another umrah. For example, somebody wants to do umrah on behalf of his mother and his father. Somebody wants to do umrah on behalf of his grandmother and his grandfather, let's say, right? I think there's a legitimate need here now, a legitimate reason that they're not being selfish, that they want to do umrah on behalf of multiple people. So, you know, the first umrah, they'll do it for their mother. Then they'll do another umrah for their father, right? In my opinion, inshallah, we should not be strict about this. And also, this is a fiqh issue. Whoever wants to do multiple umrahs, you have two of the four madhahib with you. So, bismillah, go for it. I'm not going to be strict about this. However, as a group, I'm telling you, we're not offering that as a service because, not because of any fiqh issue, but because it's complicated. Like who wants to go when and whatnot. Whoever wants to do another umrah in our group, that's their responsibility. Go take a taxi, 10 riyals, $3. Go take a taxi, and then on the way back, you'll get another taxi, you know, 3 riyals, the $3, whatever, and you do your own umrah, you're on your own. We as a group obviously cannot do this because of the logistical reasons. From a fiqh perspective, I don't have a problem. But I personally think it is better to do only one umrah per trip unless there is a reason to do so. And with this, wallahi, there were so many other things, but I did not realize that time would go by so quickly. With this, inshallah ta'ala, we'll open up the floor for questions. But before I open up your questions, I have online questions. Are we online or not? We're online now? Okay, so we have some online questions. And how can the brothers online email you or now? Are they emailing you? Okay, so those of you online... those of you online, you may email, what is the address? Umrah@yasirqadhi.com, Umrah with an H. Umrah@yasirqadhi.com right now, and Brother Danish will read the questions to me. I already have 11 questions from the people online. That's a bit of a problem. Who should I give precedence to? The Memphians are getting angry at me. Khalas, we'll do one and one. The first question is, can women run during sa'i if they choose? No, women are not supposed to run. Women are supposed to have modesty, and running destroys that modesty. Women are not supposed to run. A question from the Memphians, quickly. Yes.
For the blessings of the Umrah, they're in the range of life. In the hadith, we say many of our family go and say, you know, I'm looking for a child or a grandchild, and people know that they get blessed. But from the text of the hadith, I didn't see that.
I'm looking for a child, what do you mean?
The blessings of the Umrah.
To be given a child, like you make dua for a child. There's no explicit linkage between child and Umrah, but any dua is increased. That's the point. Okay. Is sa'i, extra sa'i, an act of worship? No. Extra tawaf is an act of worship. Extra sa'i is not an act of worship. Sa'i is only done during Umrah and Hajj, the actual arkan. Otherwise, you do not do sa'i. Tawaf, you can do as many as you want. But sa'i is only done within Umrah and Hajj. Quickly, yes.
So in the state of Hajj, a woman can enter into the state of Ihram but cannot do tawaf, as I understand.
In the state of Hajj, a woman, the majority position is that a woman cannot do tawaf in the state of Hajj. And this is the explicit hadith in Sahih Bukhari of the Prophet ﷺ, that one day on the Umrah and the Hajj, he entered the tent and Aisha was crying, and he said, "Why are you crying? Perhaps you have nafisti, yani, entered your menses." And she said, "Yes." So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Do not cry. This is something that Allah has decreed for the daughters of Adam. So you do all that the other women do, غير ألا تطوفي بالبيت, except that you don't do tawaf around the bait." So she makes dua, she does dhikr, she enters ihram, she does everything except the tawaf. And this is my position as well, that the woman in tawaf should not do, the woman in hajj should not do tawaf. And that if she does it without any necessary reason, the tawaf is batil. But in our times, looking at the need and the necessity and the difficulties of a woman who comes with a group to wait a week, right, if she's not able to do it, and change all of the dynamics, the permanent committee of scholars of the kingdom and many of the fatawa from the past have found these precedences, has said, if a woman is forced to, her situation is like a person who is constantly breaking his wudu and he has to pray. Situation is like the prisoner of war who's tied up and he cannot do wudu, he just does whatever he can and he prays. I.e. darura comes in. And I think this is a legitimate position. That if a lady cannot get out of the predicament of menses, and she finds herself in menses, and she cannot break off from the group and change flights, which is really, it really is impossible. Honestly, it's pretty much impossible. Even if you had a medical emergency, it would be almost impossible in Hajj time to break it and do it. In Umrah it's a little bit easier, but in Hajj time. So if this is the case, then for such a lady we can be exception. This is not the rule, this is the exception. And we say that, okay, in your case you are forgiven, you go and do tawaf in your state, just like the one who has incontinence, he's obvious, always breaking his wudu. We say for him, you are forgiven. We don't make this a general rule, right? And Allah knows best. So that's why, no kafara. And that's why it is good for women to take the pill if they're able to go before they do that. What is the ruling on doing Hajj or Umrah on behalf of someone elderly who is still alive? No, in my opinion, it is the majority position. Your mother, your father who are alive but they're elderly, you don't do Umrah on their behalf. You only do Umrah on behalf of those who have gone on. Somebody who's alive, unless it is Hajj Badr that they have told you to do, that something else. You cannot do a Nafil Hajj for somebody who's still there. But if it's Hajj Badr, an elderly person says, "I wasn't able to do Umrah, you know, do Umrah on my behalf," that is jaiz, if you have done Umrah or Hajj, right? If you must have done one yourself in the past, then you can do Hajj Badr or Umrah Badr.
Can you do tawaf for somebody?
The majority position is that yes, you can do tawaf for somebody else. Any action. No. Anything that's alive, these types of a'mal badaniya. No, these a'mal badaniya, actions of the body, you do not do for somebody who is alive. Actions of the body, right?
Elderly, there is no hope for them to go there.
Is this badal or not?
No.
If it's badal, then no. Sorry, if it's badal, then yes. Otherwise, no. If it's badal, which means what? They haven't done Hajj and they need you to do Hajj on their behalf. Then, so for those who say that Umrah is wajib, for those who say Umrah is wajib, then yes, for on their behalf. But for those who say Umrah is not wajib, then there is no concept of badal for Umrah, right? And also, by the way, if a person hasn't done Hajj and Umrah, it doesn't make sense to do Umrah and not Hajj. You need to go for the prize. You need to go for the Hajj, right? So if a person has not done Hajj, it doesn't make sense that somebody goes and does an Umrah on their behalf. Umrah badal. They have to do Hajj badal. Okay? Question we have over here. Please explain what should we do in terms of genders and roles in the haram. Everybody's too close, etc. You are forgiven. You فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. What can you do? You have 2 million people. You have 2 million people there. You just try your best to lower your gaze and be separate, right? It's what?
When you are in Hajj, nobody think about
this. Somebody's thinking about them. Okay, so it's you just try your best. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. And you avoid contact as much as possible. But you are forgiven. What you you can't control the crowd. What are you going to do? You are forgiven for what is over there. Yeah, go ahead.
Two questions. Is there a ritual of walking fast between two corners of Kaaba? That's first question. Second question is, if you have kafara for anything, do you have to do it in Makkah or can you do it when you come back?
So the first question is about walking fast in the between the sa'id, the tawaf, and I forgot to mention, Jazakallah for reminding me, two other sunnahs. I forgot to mention two sunnahs. The first of these sunnahs is called ramal. And ramal means the first three tawafs, you should walk a little bit faster. Practically speaking, this is not possible. Because of the crowd, you're going with the crowd, practically speaking. If you're able to in the dead of the night, if it's 3 a.m. and it's empty, which I don't think we're going to get, by the way, we're going in peak season. But if you're able to get, then alhamdulillah. Ramal is to go fast. The second, three. The second sunnah is ittiba', and ittiba' means, here, this is what I need to show you the ihram. That was the next demonstration, by the way. Might as well do this now then. Ittiba' means that you take the ihram, this is the upper one, and you lower it above the right hand, and then you do it like this, so you show the right hand. Right, this is ittiba'. And the sunnah of ittiba' is to do this for all seven. And then a big mistake, which is not a mistake, I mean, it's against the sunnah. When you finish, you're just supposed to cover it up, and then in the sa'i, you're not supposed to show it. The Prophet ﷺ covered it up in the sa'i, right? So in the seven, you're supposed to, now, there are reasons he did this, by the way. That when he did it, the Meccans, they said that the people of Medina have made them weak, right? So in order to show them that they're strong, the first three, they marched so fast. And then they showed them ittiba', they showed them their muscles, right? Now, they did it for a reason. For us, we just want to remind ourselves of the spirit, of what they did. We want to remind ourselves of the persecution. It's just following the sunnah. I mean, we don't have to, there's no Quraysh pagans, you know, monitoring us. But we remind ourselves of those times by doing that. So this is the sunnah. I also needed to show you very quickly about wearing the ihram, the bottom part of the ihram for the brothers. A number of you asked me to do this. I'll have to go here for this. Where's the
mic? You know, I don't need the mic. Just do this like this. Okay.
Check the brothers, mic. They won't be able to hear you.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
We use the wireless.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Where's the wireless going?
Obviously, it's a big problem for the brothers because many of them are not conscious of their awrah. And honestly, one needs to be very conscious of one's awrah because you're not wearing any undergarments, so it's very problematic. And even if the umrah is only going to last half a day, you're going to be in the bus, you're going to be walking, you always need to be conscious. The easiest way that covers the maximum awrah is as follows. Put your right leg forward. Put your right leg forward so that you have a walking distance, that you know how much you have. Take the ihram from one corner, and fold up around 6 or 7 inches, a little bit of it over here. Fold up a little bit of it to give you the first protection. And you put it basically at your right leg. And put it a bit high so that you have space to walk, right? And also it is sunnah to have it above the ankles anyway, any garment. So you have it a bit high. Then you come around. And you have, of course, anybody who wears a lungi, by the way, I mean, you need to teach us, right? So you come around over here. And then you do the same thing in the corner. And what this does is, look, it gives you a good window. You see this? Covering. You see this? It gives you a good window to cover up. Right? Because once you do this, now, of course, you'll wear the belt. You should remember another point. The belt has to be at the belly button because technically the belly button is awrah. A lot of you make the mistake of wearing the belt where you wear the Western pants belt, right? Then you lower it and then the belly button is showing. And technically the belly button is the awrah. So you should put the belly button into the awrah so that the belt should be tied here. And then when you lower it, so you have now space to walk, right? A problem comes if you don't put those and you just wrap it around, you're literally like a mummy, you cannot walk anymore. So you just do it in this manner. Once again, it's very simple. The two corners, just give a little bit of folding here,
and then put the crease where your right leg is. And that's going to be the easiest for you then to walk around. Put the crease where the right leg is. And also, by the way, once you get the hang of it, you can easily fix the ihram without taking the belt off. You can fix the ihram in public in front of everybody once you figure out what each of these corners does, right? So this corner, you just figure it out, and the belt is at your waist, and then you can fold it. And of course, wearing a belt is not problematic at all. And also, for the men especially, you need to have your wallets and whatnot. So they give you that pouch that you can put under this, and that can double, if that fits you perfectly, that can double as a belt and as a pouch to keep your stuff in. One more point, sad to say, but I know this is very shocking for many of you, but there are pickpockets even in the haram. There are pickpockets even in the haram, and there are people who, they will steal your money as you are doing tawaf around the Kaaba, and they will cut your pouch and get some money out and whatnot, or they will take out of your wallet. These are, yani, what can you say, this is the reality, right? This is the reality, and they are professionals. They know exactly what they're doing. So be very careful of lots of cash, of your passport, of anything of this nature. If you're, if the hotel has a safe, then just take enough cash as much as you need and leave everything over there. It is a very big problem, unfortunately. But in any case, I know we have a lot of questions, but time, we need to pray Isha. The kafara, the kafara should be done in Mecca, but it is not necessary. It's also easier to do it in Mecca, and it's also more blessed to do it in Mecca, but it is not necessary to do it in Mecca. You can do it over here, not a problem, inshallah. If there are other questions, I'm with you on the group, alhamdulillah, so that's the benefit. We can do it throughout the entire trip to Dubai or Mecca or Medina. We can answer questions, inshallah. Two more questions from online. Okay, bismillah.
One brother is asking, what would be our intention or niyyah for this Umrah? Did you go over the actual niyyah?
We went over the niyyah. We just said, labbaik Allahumma Umrah. That's all you need to do. There's no other intention for the Umrah per se.
And one other brother is asking, can we wear boxers under the ihram? And then also, is there a height limit for the ihram?
No, you're not supposed to wear any types of undergarments, because that's the whole point. You're not supposed to wear undergarments under the ihram. As for the height limit, one size fits all. For those who are tall, you just have to have it basically above the ankles and below the knees. So that's fine. For those who are short, you can fold the top garment out and do it like that. Bit of an awkward thing to say, but brothers, put some Vaseline between your thighs. This comes in handy immensely when you are doing tawaf and sa'i, right? Many of you have not experienced why we wear underwear, we don't know. You will find out why we wear underwear during tawaf and sa'i. So, especially the Hajj for 3 days, but even for Umrah, it comes in handy. It comes in handy. Just a little bit of Vaseline between the thighs, because the friction will cause a lot of irritation. So just a little bit of Vaseline comes in handy. Bit awkward, but it is very essential, and you will thank me for it. Inshallah ta'ala. Yeah, we mentioned,
You said about, for the Hajj, you said if somebody wants to wear a mask, you get kafara, that's okay.
Yes, these days, with all of the diseases and whatnot, I think it is not a problem. In Hajj time, in Umrah, I don't, you know, but in Hajj time, I don't see a problem if it's so difficult to do that and wear kafara, inshallah. Yes.
What's considered peak? What's off peak during the day, during the evening? When is it best to do? If you're going to do an extra Umrah, when are you better to do it?
In the summertime, peak would be right after Dhuhr. Peak for you, meaning the empty time. Nobody is going to be in June at 12 and 1 p.m. You will be able to kiss the black stone as much as you want. But if anything happens, don't blame me. June in Mecca, you will see what desert heat is. Right? But yeah, if you want to do it like... Otherwise, yani, frankly, we are going in peak season. Anyway, June. We are going in a season where it's the vacations, and I think any time of the day or night you go, you will have a good... crowd. However, obviously, common sense tells you 2 a.m., 3 a.m., you're not going to get as many people as after Asr and Maghrib, right?
So even in Hajj, immediately after Isha, that's the time when people are going out to eat. That's the best time I found, even in Hajj. It was one of the lowest volume. Immediately after Isha, they're going out to eat. They've spent the whole day in the Haram. They're going out to eat. So if you do it at that time, it'll be easy.
And the best thing, honestly, monitor the first day. Use your own monitor. And you'll see for yourself when there's a rough, time. But inshallah, it's not as bad as Hajj. I mean, we're going in Umrah time. Inshallah, it's doable, inshallah. Alhamdulillah. Inshallah, with this, we need... Okay, yes, one last announcement. Okay, go ahead.